Alright, I hope you had some fun on the previous parts, especially part 3 where I was showing the procedural stacks. I think that was very interesting to see how you can achieve that kind of look. And today, in part 4, I will be showing you how to do all of this in Solaris. Technically, we are reusing things of part 3, but in order to make the instancing work, we still kind of need to recreate this for Solaris, which is Houdini's USD context. This is my working scene. The bottom here is technically just what I had to do in the end to render everything on disk. So we will not be focusing too much on this render stage area. But again, you will get insights on that on the Patreon if you want to get the full scenes. It's all there. But today we will be focusing on this data stream here, which will show pretty much everything that is needed. So the first thing is I want to import the sub-level camera, which I'm doing via this. And you can see it's already coming in here. And I'm just adding a background image, which is my plate image, to the camera. It's nothing crazy, very simple stuff, just that I have my background image here as well. Then sometimes in order to do a proper USD workflow, you ideally create these USD safe files. Again, I will not go into the details of Solaris itself. I will just show an example of the scene. But it's a good habit to, whenever you have a certain department checkpoint, to save it to disk. So that's what I'm doing here. I'm loading in the camera and I'm outputting this here. You can see as a ROP, USD ROP that renders that USD file to disk. And then you will also notice I have several switches in here, camera on, camera off, and they will be driven at the bottom. So the first thing now, obviously, as you can see, we just have the camera. The bottom here is my scene graph tree, which shows what is currently in the scene at the current given location that I'm viewing from. And I'm now viewing from switch number 2. I've got 2 data streams. You can see one is going to the right, this guy, and then one main is on the left-hand side. And the run on the right, I showed roughly in the part 2. This is kind of the shading tree and my LookDev tree where I was just putting them next to each other to do simple LookDev. All right, so now let's see how we can get the instancing working. We'll see if I view from the instancer, we are getting the shacks here and they are floating, and this is exactly the same result we are getting on the sub level, the surface operator level, but now we are in the lighting operator on the Solaris end. How it works is there's an instancer node, and behind the scenes, this is essentially a copy to points. There's nothing different to it. So you just have your points and then you have your prototypes, which are then being instanced on the points. So you have several options on the instancer. You can use an internal sub to get the target points. You can point it to an external surface operator, or just several different options, right? And I'm using the internal sub to have my instance points. I'm pointing the prototypes as my second input, and you can see they have an index attribute named check ID. This means if there's a correlation between my prototype index attribute and the point attribute, if there is a correlation, then this prototype will go to that specific point. Now let's dive into the prototypes, and you can see I'm pulling in exactly the same data as I showed in part 3 where we go into the big for loop. In the end, I'm just moding a couple of things so they arrive on the USD stage. And then in the end, this is the data I'm passing. So it's name, path, check ID is the important one, which is the data on the geometry. The instancer, funny enough, I could have done this differently, but because I did it first in SOPs and surface operator, I'm technically pulling in my final result here. I'm blasting everything but the shacks. Because they are packed, I can just remove the geometry and just retain the packed points, which I'm doing right here. So this is now my point, and they already have the check ID and everything applied to them. You can see check ID. I could display the name if needed, but this is exactly what I need. And then that's out points. And then in the instancer, just as I said, copies the things to those points. And you will see there's a different icon here in the scene graph tree. It's like a little instancer icon, hard to read, but you have your prototypes. You can see I've got right now 5 prototypes. They are just, you know, instanced on those points. For the tutorial, I just changed my object for loop. You can see here to just 5. You can do as many as you want. I just did 5 because it's a little bit quicker to go over everything. So, but you should have access to everything. You can go crazy as you want. Similar thing to, if I go to the stack, sorry, you will see I just have 1 tower here. And at the top, you can easily just switch between all the towers or just the single one. Anyway, so going back to LOPS, you can hold N to get this little picker here and then go back to LOPS. And now I have to do the same thing with the props, right? The props are my little barrel, water tanks or whatever. Kind of doing the same exact thing, unpacking them, and then the same stuff. I'm pulling in my final geo, just extracting all the props, doing the same ad, so I just have the points, cleaning a couple of things to retain just the needed attributes. Back to stage, you can see it's now prop ID instead of shack ID, and then I'm just instancing those on top of that as well. So now we should have the props exactly the same as before. And a cool thing which I didn't show, I've got this little barrel fire VDB. Let's see if I can actually zoom in here. Can't zoom. Sometimes this, the zoom function doesn't really work. I don't know why. If I hit Shift R or just go to the menu and hit Arnold, this will pull up Arnold render menu. Probably depth of field is on by default, which we do want to disable. There we go. So this is my fire VDB. I did that very quickly in Axiom. Very simple to do. This is a single sequence. You can see pulling in this, assigning a volume shader. Cool thing here in the instancer. It's the same kind of idea. Pulling in everything, keeping the props, and then blasting everything which has prop ID 0. And I know I checked which prop is prop ID 0, and that is the barrel. I'm just cleaning things up, adjusting the scale of the fire. I did that after the fact. A random orientation on the fire, and then I'm just instancing the fire. You can see it's now instanced on all the barrels. And if I do a render maybe from here, go back to the Arnold menu, start up Arnold, you can see now we have the fire in all of this, and it's very quick. You can see we have a couple of fires in this tower. They're barely visible on the scale here, but you can see that there is a little bit of illumination going on from them. Pretty cool, pretty cool. And again, here I'm doing like USG RUP, so I'm just rendering out the fire sequence, because I did in the end render them separately because I didn't want to render everything again. So this is just me doing a little hacky thing to render a separate render path for just a fire. And you'll see in the next part, in part 5, the comp layers I created in the end. This guy is a barrel fire, enable or disable it. By default, this is on. And this sub import is just a very basic import. There's nothing to it. I'm technically going to subs. I'm finding this out vertical beams, this stuff here, going back to lobs, and I'm just importing it. So there's no instancing on these pillars. And then the same with the beams. It's a sub create. I actually don't know why I just didn't import this. There must have been a reason. Maybe because of the cleanup stage here, but in the end, I'm just importing the beams, importing the wires. You can see there's nothing. I'm actually just blasting it the same way as I did on the instancing. Stack paths, very basic stuff. All of this is imports. Cool thing now here is with the instancing of the lights. So important to know that if you have a light that you want to instance, you can see now this is an Arnold sphere light. It has an AOV checks, which I can use in comp to just play with that light group. Got my basic parameters for this light. Cool thing now, the instancer you can see is the location is not internal, it's an external sub. And it is actually going to my out lights. So these lights here, you'll see, they have a, if I preview the, open up the, sorry, the preview window, but open up the spreadsheet from this location, you can see they have a CD attribute. Very handy. If points have a CD attribute and you use them in an instancer, the lights will actually get that. And you can see in the viewport now that it's not very accurate, but you can see where the lights are. You can see kind of the colors they have as well. Important, as I said, the lights method needs to be referenced. Point instancer does not work on lights. You need to reference them. And then you can have as many lights as you want. In this instance, this tower has 490 lights. Nothing crazy. Arnold can easily handle that. And then with the new light sample feature, this is a treat. This is really nicely sampling it. And then this is potentially a basic stack. And for now, I'll be ignoring this step here because this kind of is a copy of one stack. And then I'm instancing that. So you can see in the scene files how I did it. I essentially cached out a single one and then used points and copied that all over the place. I can probably dive in here and showing you these points. So from the camera view, you can see these points. I will show maybe an example in the end. These points will all instance towers, complete stack towers, which is quite handy because it's all instanced. Let me just show this. So if I go here, it will take a bit. You can see now all the towers are being loaded. It's all still instanced. You can see we've got this stack instance towers group. And my prototypes are, I think, 5 or 6 individual different towers, which I'm just instancing in the distance. So that's how I was able to get all the data. It's a non-issue for Arnold to do this. And then I've got all the lights doing the same thing. So all of these distant towers will get their distinct lights, same way as I copied a single one. And I'm just setting a render purpose on these guys. So they are only, if I go back to preview, if I change my display here, it should switch it, which I'm not sure why. There we go. It's kind of hiding them, but they are there. They're just not in the viewport. So this is what this is doing. So it's quite handy to disable things that you don't want to see in the viewport. So when I put the proxy, they just disappear. If I go to render, you'll see they'll pop back up, or they don't, but they will definitely show up in the render. And here, material assignments, you can see this. These are just hard-coded paths to the locations. So I'm just picking the locations here. We can dive in here. This is what I did in part two. I was working just on the walls shader, but in the end, these are all very similar shaders, very kind of the same idea, just maybe different hue shifts. Again, it's nothing crazy on the shading end. Put in a triplanar, offset that, and that's it. Same with these guys. These are just shader assignments. And then we've got the moonlight, which is a kind of a bluish light, a very soft angular size of the sun, and just an AOV group so I can separate them. I've got a switch here as well, which just pulls in the LookDev lights versus the actual render lights. And it's all driven by a variable, and I'll show you how to set those in a second. We've got preview here, and then these are all these context variables, and these are in the end driving the switches. It's quite easy. You just create a edit context options node. You can create one. This one is named barrel fire. The option is one. And then whenever I read that, I can disable the fire or not. If I go to my main camera and I view from my render settings node, actually I forgot to bring the light samples next. So let's add some light samples. And if I go now and hit render, Arnold does initialize with all the instancing and everything. One of these switches are actually disabling the instance towers in the back because I just want to be a little bit more performant for the tutorial here. But for your sake, you can just, you know, change the value and then it should work just fine. First initialization takes a little bit, but then once it's in memory, super quick. Can see now this is the initial check. Let's say I want to change the LookDev lights. I can just go to my context var, enable this to one, and then we are switching out the lights. You can see that now this right hand stream here is enabled, and we're just bypassing, we're adding an additional light, moonlight plus the LookDev lights, which then gives you this result. I have disabled the AUVs because they kind of slow down the scene if you have too many, so I just got rid of them. Yeah, different options here, context for the LookDev environment. So if I shift R to disable this, I can enable the LookDev, which then bypasses technically everything of the instancing. And we're just going to my very simple checks. And this is what I used to do quick LookDev prototyping. It's easier to have them in a line so you can really see what's going on. There you go. These are my very simple, I don't know, whenever I rotate, it sometimes seems to just disable them. Yeah, these are my textures. As I said, it's nothing sophisticated, but from the distance that we are viewing it, it's more than enough. And again, if you want to bring back the scene, we can now go to the LookDev, disable this. It will load the whole scene again. And if I want to bring the instance stacks, I can enable them. So now they are being loaded. They should be disabled unless I change the purpose here. Let's see what's going on. It's on render, I don't know. So we can just see if I go to my render view and I go back to Arnold. You can now see that we have all the towers in memory. It says 54, but I have several things open on other windows. So I started on 19%, I think. So it's potentially 10 gigs max that I'm using. It's probably even exaggerated. But yeah, so this loads a lot of lights, a lot of geo, and a lot of data, lots of textures and all of that. And if I go back to my main view, it takes a little bit of time to render. I think a frame was like 10 minutes probably, a frame. And we can quickly go over the render settings. Because I'm using deadline farm management, I had to do it slightly different than a usual approach. I had to do USDA files, which are ASCII files, which are readable. because I had to do path remapping because I'm using Windows and Linux machines. It's just two personal computers, so it's nothing crazy. I don't have a render farm per se, it's just two machines which help me out. So I'm fetching the data from above and then setting the variables that I need. I have my render settings node here. And then this essentially is my USD render rub, which I'm caching out to disk. So I'm creating a USDA file per frame. And then in deadline, I can pull that in each frame and render that using Arnold Kick. Very efficient, very cool to use. And then I did just a couple of other passes as well. So as I said, the barrel fire out is just the fires itself because I did them after the fact. And these are just my render outputs. I hope this gave you a quick and nice overview of the Solaris context and how I approached it. I think it's a very modular system because I can instance it the same way as I did. Right now, this is just pulling everything into one kind of file. It's not a production scene, I would say, because in production, you probably have different departments caching out different USD files per department. So you would have a modeling USDA, layout USDA, LookDev USDA, lighting USD, USD file, and a render USD file, which you then using sublayers or whatever, bring them in. But in this case, because it's just me working on this project, I just work in one USD file technically. I do render out several ones for my safekeeping, but in the end, it's just one big USD file that gets rendered. As I said, I will probably do like a production, I'm not sure if I would call it production, but a more sophisticated USD tutorial where I'm talking about the meaning of what it's supposed to be and what I'm doing. Probably both work just fine, but the intention is to collaborate with different departments at the same time, which I'm definitely not showing in this case. But either way, this should give you a quick insight on how to do it with Arnold, how to use instancing and make things work the way the same way as before. I hope you enjoyed this. Please leave me a comment below and obviously subscribe if you haven't done so. So thank you so much, and the next one will be compositing.